Good morning and welcome to First Presbyterian Church, Greeneville, Tennessee, to this live portion of our worship. We pray that God continues to bless you during these very unique and transitioning times in our lives and culture. So let us continue this morning as we go to God in prayer. Gracious God, for your love that surrounds us this day, for opportunities to worship wherever we may be, we pray that you continue to guide us and show us all of the things that you have in store for us, your blessings, your opportunities, as we learn to minister in very unique and different ways during this time, and as we learn to transition in our families, as we see more of each other and have opportunities to be home, may we continue to bring honor and glory to you in all of our life. And we pray that you continue to guide us this day as we worship you, lifting our voices, lifting up your name, and we praise you. We pray these in all things through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Those of you who were gathered with us last week may remember that we talked a little bit about Jacob and his biblical quarantine or social distancing, if you will, from his brother Esau. After the porridge incident and after he and his mother conspired to steal the blessing of the firstborn from Esau. This week we're going to continue the story, but we're going to jump forward about 20 years to another significant event in Jacob's life. But before I do that, I want to tell you a little story about how I was reminded of this particular event, and then we'll set the backstory and then read the scripture. A pastor friend of mine, Michelle Bartell, who is the transitional or interim pastor of a church right now, has covenanted with her congregation to send them every day an email from her, not just a brief note, but an email challenging them to practice their faith more fully in these difficult times. And the title that she uses for that email is While We Are Apart. And I managed to get on that email list from her, and I've actually shared one of those with the session this last week. But as I was reading that, she begins each email with that title and ends it with While We Are Apart. It reminded me of something that I experienced almost 25 years ago. When I first got to the church in Fayetteville, Tennessee, I joined the choir, not because I can sing, but because I can follow along if someone else is singing. And one of the things that I learned very quickly was that that choir had a closing ritual at each of its choir practices that I learned later had been going on for at least 25 years before I got there, and perhaps it is still going on today. This is how the close of each of the choir practices goes. At the close, after they have rehearsed all they're going to rehearse for the day, the choir stands up and in unison repeats these words. The Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another. Now, when I first heard that, I said, well, that sounds very biblical and very King James, but I'm not really sure where it comes from, and I had to ask someone. It turns out that it comes from the book of Genesis. It is, in fact, from Jacob's story. It is called the Mizpah, which means watchtower. Now, I remember that and thought about how, as I looked at the entire story out of which that verse comes, has a rather unusual context that really doesn't sound like it's very comforting. But for the choir there that repeats that every week, it was a reminder as we walked out the door to go our separate ways that, in fact, it is the self of God who watches over us, and we claim that as we part ways so that we might be kept in God's watch care throughout the course of the week until we come back together as a choir. Now, last week, I think I read to you from about the 28th chapter of Genesis. It was the story of what we sometimes call Jacob's ladder, or the stairway to heaven, as Jacob saw in his dream. As he was leaving his brother and his mother and father, headed over to Haran to, under the pretense of finding a wife for himself, because his mother said she wanted him to go back to where she came from so that he could find a wife from there. And there in the midst of the wilderness, in a place that was originally called Luz, Jacob experienced the very presence of God in a dream, stacked stones there, and said, "This place contains the very presence of God." And we changed the name of that place to Beth El. Well, we're going to fast forward about 20 years, because that's where our reading for today from chapter 31. So that's a lot of years to go through in just three chapters. But we're going to give you the very short backstory on that, so that you can catch up to what's going on when we read the scripture and know exactly how it fits within the context of Jacob's story. Now, the story is that Jacob comes to Paddan Aram in the region of Haran, and there finds his uncle, his mother's brother, Laban, and falls in love with one of Laban's daughters, Rachel, and asks his uncle if he can marry her. After all, that's why he went there in the first place. And the uncle says, "Well, yes, you can, but you're going to have to work for me for 7 years before you can marry her. So he dutifully fills out his 7 years of labor, and at the end of 7 years, the wedding is planned, and lo and behold, Laban pulls a fast one on him, because the night of the wedding feast, Laban slips not Rachel, that Jacob wanted to marry, into the tent with him, into the marriage tent, but her older sister Leah. And the next morning, when Jacob finds out, he asks Laban about it, and Laban says, "Well, didn't you read the fine print in the marriage contract? Where we come from, it is not proper for the younger sister to get married before the older sister. And so, of course you married Leah." Well, that doesn't make Jacob very happy. You can imagine how it makes Leah feel to hear all this conversation going on. And so Jacob agrees to work for another 7 years so that he can also have Rachel as his bride. You can imagine that made Leah feel really great also. And so the next years after that, there's a lot of, let's just cut to the chase, and there's a lot of, "I'm having your baby, I'm not having your baby, I can't have your baby, so take my maid," back and forth between Rachel and Leah and their handmaids, to the point where Jacob has a house full of sons and even a daughter. Now, after 7 years of working for one bride and another 7 years of working for another bride, then Jacob begins to wonder if he's ever going to get paid anything that he can carry with him, of course, other than his family. And he negotiates with Laban for a way for him to get paid. He says to Laban, "You know, your flocks have really grown since I've been with you these 14 years. And what I'd like to do is I'd like for you to pay me with just a few of the flocks, the sheep and goats. Most of your goats and your sheep are solid color. Occasionally there's a speckled one or a spotted one or a striped one there. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to take just the speckled and the spotted ones, and those will be mine. And that way, when our flocks are separated, it will be easy to tell what's yours and what's mine." And so Laban agrees to that, but behind Jacob's back, Laban goes out and takes all of the speckled, striped, and spotted lambs and goats and sends them off with other parts of his family away from where they are, so that Jacob really starts out with nothing to work with. But Jacob has a little hoodoo of his own, because he takes almond and poplar branches and carves little speckles and streaks and spots in them, and when the sheep and the goats come to water when they are preparing to mate, he holds up those sticks in front of them, and somehow that causes them to produce many more speckled and spotted and streaked and striped animals. And so his flock grows exceedingly, and Laban's does not so much. So that's the backstory for what's going on. And then in chapter 31, Jacob hears in a dream from God that he is to go back home, that God will bless him. Now remember, Jacob has already promised God there out in Bethel in the wilderness before he came to Paddan Aram that he will give God one-tenth of everything that he gains throughout the course of his life. And so when God tells him to go back home, he decides that he will do that, but he doesn't really trust his uncle Laban. Remember that Jacob's name literally means the grabber, because he was actually holding on to his twin brother's foot when they were born. Well, it turns out that he apparently gets that from his mother's side of the family, because his uncle Laban has tried to grab everything he can from Jacob for the 20 years that he's been there. So Jacob decides that he will slip off in the night with all of his flocks and with both of his wives and their handmaids and all of his children, and he will head back home. And he gets about a three-day head start on Laban before Laban even finds out about it, because Laban is off shearing the sheep. Well, Laban easily catches up with him, because flocks and families don't move nearly as fast as angry father-in-laws. And Laban catches up with him, and then has this conversation with him in the middle of the wilderness there, where we pick up the story today. I'm going to read Genesis 31, beginning with verse 28. And here's how we pick up in the middle of the story, after Laban overtakes Jacob. This is Laban speaking, and he says, "And why did you not permit me to kiss my sons and my daughters farewell? What you have done is foolish. It is in my power to do you harm, but the God of your father spoke to me last night, saying, take heed that you speak to Jacob neither good nor bad, even though you had to go because you longed greatly for your father's house. Why did you steal my gods?" Jacob answered Laban, "Because I was afraid, for I thought that you would take your daughters from me by force. But anyone with whom you find your gods shall not live. In the presence of our kinfolk, point out what I have that is yours and take it." Now Jacob did not know that Rachel had stolen Laban's gods. So Laban went into Jacob's tent and into Leah's tent and into the tent of the two maids, but he did not find them. And he went out of Leah's tent and entered Rachel's. Now Rachel had taken the household gods and put them in the camel's saddle and sat on them. Laban felt about all the tent but did not find them. And she said to her father, "Let not my lord be angry that I cannot rise before you, for the way of women is upon me." So he searched, but did not find the household gods. Then Jacob became angry and upbraided Laban. Jacob said to Laban, "What is my offense? What is my sin that you have hotly pursued me? Although you have felt about through all my goods, what have you found of all your household goods? Set it here before my kinsfolk and your kinsfolk, so that they may decide between us. These 20 years I have been with you, your ewes and your female goats have not miscarried, and I have not eaten the rams of your flocks. That which was torn by wild beasts I did not bring to you. I bore the loss of it myself. Of my hand you required it, whether stolen by day or stolen by night. It was like this with me. By day the heat consumed me, and the cold by night, and my sleep fled from my eyes. These 20 years I have been in your house. I served you 14 years for your two daughters and 6 years for your flock, and you have changed my wages 10 times. If the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had not been on my side, surely now you would have sent me away empty-handed. God saw my affliction and the labor of my hands and rebuked you last night." Then Laban answered and said to Jacob, "The daughters are my daughters, the children are my children, the flocks are my flocks, and all that you see is mine. But what can I do today about these daughters of mine, or about their children whom they have born? Come now, let us make a covenant, you and I, and let it be a witness between you and me." So Jacob took a stone and set it up as a pillar. And Jacob said to his kinfolk, gather stones. And they took stones and made a heap. And they ate there by the heap. Laban called it Yegar Shadutha, but Jacob called it Galim. Laban said, this heap is a witness between you and me today. Therefore he called it Galim. And the pillar of Mizpah, for he said, the Lord watch between you and me when we are absent one from the other. Now, as I read this story, it occurs to me that these words that Laban has said to Jacob, the Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another, are really more a threat, a curse, an incantation, if you will. It is as if Laban is saying, you better hope that God has your back if we ever meet again. And I wonder, is it possible that in our current melees of blame and refusal to take responsibility in our culture, I wonder if God can take our divisive threats and our incantations aimed at those we perceive to be entirely other and turn those into blessings and encouragements in the same way that the choir in faith could do that with Laban's words for their choir members. I've got to tell you, I'm betting the farm on that. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us go to God in prayer. Eternal and ever-present God, we know you are close to all in need. And we know that our prayers for others bring us closer to you. We are bold to claim for others your promises of new life in Jesus Christ as we claim them for ourselves. Especially we pray for friends and family members, for neighbors in special need, for those from whom we are estranged. Especially we pray for victims of violence or warfare, for help for those who are abused or neglected, for people who live in poverty, for those who are hungry and thirsty, for those who are outcast and strangers, for those who are lonely and forgotten, for those who cannot work this day, for those who are captive or imprisoned, for those who have no leisure. Especially we pray for those who are isolated by sickness or sorrow, for those who suffer mental anguish, for those who face death, for those who weep with grief, for those who are in need of healing, for the renewal of those who despair, for those who keep watch over the sick and the dying, for those who work for the benefit of others, for those who share what they have with others, for those who offer welcome and hospitality, and for agents of caring and relief. Especially we pray for peace and justice in the world and for the healing of the nations. Great God, you are one God, and you bring together what is scattered, and you mend what is broken. Unite us with the scattered people of the earth, that we may be one family of your children. Bind up all our wounds and heal us in spirit, for your compassion is unbounded, and your mercy is endless. Take our words and the emotions they elicit, both from ourselves and others, and transform us all by your grace. Fill us with hope and give us a deep hunger for reconciliation. O God of love, we pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, who reigns with you in the power and unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now.
now and forever. Amen.
I invite you, as we prepare to conclude this audio-visual portion of our worship service, to go at 11 o'clock and listen to the audio portion, which can be found on FM 95.5 or 1450 AM or jewel955.com. Or you can also find it on the church's website, firstpresgreenville.org, if you click on the sermons. 30-minute audio podcast is available. So now I charge you, as those who have participated from a distance, to go out into the world and maintain our connection. Stay safe. Know that we will be in touch, and remember that you can